And the first time I really recognized the wah-wah pedal, I would say it would have to be Eric Clapton in the Cream days.
I think that was it. And it was from Disraeli Gears, and it was the song Tales of Brave Ulysses. And what happens is that when you hear something different, and it is a time that is speaking different languages to you, then you do take note.
I've actually heard from a number of people who've told me over the years that Frank was, if not the first, one of the very first people that ever performed with the wah pedal. And I believe it. I mean, he was always looking for different things to embellish what he was doing musically and certainly with his guitar. People have said Del Kasher is responsible for it or has a big role in it. He actually played with my dad for a period of time, so he could be the link to how Frank knew about it.
I loved working with Frank Zappa, and he was very innovative. And I said, Frank, you got to buy one of these. And so he did buy one at Manny's in New York, and he took to the wah-wah pedal immediately.
But the thing is, he was also, unlike a lot of other people, well, obviously in many ways, but in the sense that, you know, Frank really used it for tone shaping, and I think it's brilliant because all the mid-range stuff that it can bring into focus for the listener is right where that guitar lives, and I think it's something that will always sound good. It will never ever go out of style to use a wah in that way. I know that some people have talked about whether or not Frank introduced the wah pedal to Jimi Hendrix. They were definitely friends, and they would play together and meet up in different places in New York and London.
The first thing that comes to my mind when someone drops the word wah-wah on me, I think James Marshall Hendrix, for a very simple reason, that he was and always will be the complete and utter master of his craft and of the use of the wah-wah, period, end of story.
He just took advantage of all the things that were available to him technically, but he was just doing what was contemporary to him and his experiences at that time. So as soon as he was into a proper studio with a knowledgeable engineer like Eddie Kramer, he was off to the races.
I first became aware of the wah-wah when I heard Jimi Hendrix play in 1966 in London. He had just entered the charts with Hey Joe, and then of course the subsequent records had wah-wah all over it. And then I got to work with him in January of 67. So yeah, I was pretty much aware of it then, and it was pretty scary when you hear that sound screaming at you. You go, whoa, what is that?
In the sense of composition, I mean, I think, you know, one of the classic compositions on Crybaby's got to be Voodoo Child, you know? I mean, that's the first time somebody plugs in a wah-wah pedal, what's the first thing they play?
Wow, oh wow, oh wow.
I mean, come on, it's almost like you can't help it.
The combination of delay and the way he uses the wah-wah is just amazing to me. I mean, some of the most memorable riffs are done with wah.
And that's not a Marshall amp at this time. This was a Fender. It was a Fender Dual Showman with 810s in the cabinet. So when he kicks in that wah, it just explodes in the room. You know, it's just got that marvelous visceral sort of feel to it. I think his foot was lightning fast. And just to watch him in the studio do tricks with the guitar and the pedal, and it's all one thing. It never, you couldn't even begin to imagine, how the hell did he do that? You think, well, wait a minute, that's physically impossible. Because he was so integrated with the thought process from the brain through the heart, into the fingers, to the feet. It's all one fluid motion. And to be able to have watched him up close, and how much of a genius he was at pulling sounds out of that thing that were just unheard of.
Probably the first time I ever heard it was the same as most people, was probably Hendrix, you know. And then probably the top one is Page.
You know, that classic moment of Dazed and Confused where he hits the two harmonics.
wah, 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 wah. You're just like, that's awesome. That's rad. How do you do? You know, and that's not something you can, any other pedal you can just turn on. It's going to do it. You know, it's actually, you've got to control that. So it's got a feeling. It's like a human element to it.
My favorite wah, wah moment in history. I think I'd have to say Jeff Beck on Superstitious. That was one of the coolest wah-wah pedal sounds I've ever heard.
Terry Kath, you know, the 25 or 64. You know, I think that was like one of those kind of pivotal wah experiences that's kind of hard to get out of your head.
When someone says wah-wah pedal, the first thing jumps in my mind is the late, great Earl Hooker. He was the first one I saw with the wah-wah pedal long before Jimi Hendrix. And when I saw him play that, he made a record called Wah Wah Blues. And when I heard that, I'm like saying, what's next? You know, I got to go and figure out what I need to make me better.
But yeah, the first time I had ever heard a wah pedal and was actually conscious about it was at this kid's house. He put on a Thin Lizzy album. There was a guitar solo. And I said to my friend, why does his guitar sound like that? And my friend said, oh, he's using a wah-wah pedal. And I thought, wah-wah pedal, what a weird name.
You don't necessarily just have to use it on a guitar. Like Geezer Butler on the first Sabbath album, I believe, on the bass solo, using a wah-wah.
It's about the sound and what it makes you feel like when you hear it. And some of the stuff on Black Sabbath records, you know, the bass parts that Geezer played and Tony Iommi's playing, he definitely had a way with using the pedal that sounded different to me than some other people.
But also, you know, Rufus and Chaka Khan. I mean, that was done in a way like, whoa, what's that? You'd think the wah-wah pedal was made for funk.
In the areas of R&B and soul music, I think Sly Stone has to be credited. In his band, I believe, we heard one of the first fusions of the wah-wah sound. He was one of those first artists who broke down the barriers, the genres of music. Norm Whitfield, a staff producer who had worked with the Temptations through their early years, heard what was happening with Sly and the Family Stone and began to put that into the Temptations sound. Just at the same time that they were beginning to address social issues with songs like Cloud Nine and Ball of Confusion, there you had a new era for Temptations and for Motown.
I think the first time the wah-wah pedal was used on an R&B soul record is when I played it on Cloud Nine by the Temptations at Motown. I feel kind of a connection with the Crybaby wah-wah pedal because it really got me my shot at Motown playing with the Funk Brothers every day. And how that had happened was I was part of a producer's workshop at Motown. I was hired by James Jamerson, the bass player over there. And one day Norman Whitfield, the producer at Motown, came over and he had the chart to this song called Cloud Nine. So he put the chart in front of us and he said, well, let's run this down. He was searching for something. And I just happened to have my trusty Crybaby in my bag of tricks. And I pulled out the wah-wah pedal and I put it on the introduction figure that he had on the chart. And when he heard that wah-wah pedal, he said, that's it, that's what I want. So within 2 weeks, I was at Hissville, and I was recording Cloud Nine with Attempts, and that was it.
When I first got to Motown, I didn't play the wah-wah. But there was a guy named Dennis Coffey that did Cloud Nine, Ball of Confusion, and all that stuff. And I'm saying, damn, I said, where you get that from? He said, oh, man, it's a wah-wah pedal. You get it such and such. So I went and bought a wah-wah pedal. So I looked at it, and it had the directions, and like up and down, up and down. And I said, wah-kum, wah-kum, wah-kum. I said, but that's all it do? So I said, okay, fine. So I took this damn thing home, and I was like, wah-kum, 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 wah-kum. So every time we got a chance to play, we'd be playing, beep, beep. And I said, wackum, 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 because that's all I knew, because I looked at the direction and said, just go back and forth. And I never forget the horn players. They were older guys, because we were young. And they said, I wish he turned that chicka, chicka, wah, wah shit down. I just got to the point, I'm saying, I would like to make it sound like something else other than wah-wah, but have control of it, that if I wanted to say wah-wah, it would say wah-wah. Because it's like, it was the 3rd of September, wah-wah-wah-wah.
It was the 3rd of September.
When I did Papa Was a Rolling Stone, I was using a crybaby. And when I was in Motown, everything, all of the work that I did was basically the crybaby. I did the Jackson 5, Marvin Gaye, like Let's Get It On, Four Tops, Rolls Royce, Car Wash, Barry White Love's theme, Blondie, Gloria Gaynor, I Will Survive, Peaches and Herb, The Pointer Sisters, Barbra Streisand Main Event, Quincy Jones Body Heat, The Dukes of Hazzard, Death Wish, Charles Bronson. I think what changed my life about the approach that I would take is after I heard Chef. See, because a lot of people associate me playing Chef. I didn't play Chef.
Now, you want to know how Chef was created? We were in Culver City with Gordon Parks, Isaac Hayes, and I played lead guitar on this particular song, Chef. We were looking for something that would go with the walk. You know, the walk when you came out of the subway, right? I remember he said, told Willie Hall, the drummer, he said, man, give me some 16th notes. While that was happening, Isaac was at the piano. Ding, you know, ding, trying to create something. Me, I tuned my guitar up, okay? And then I was checking my pedals out. So when I got the fuzz blade, ding, da, da, you know, whatever I played, got to the echo blade, some stuff, and then got to the wah-wah, and I said, doom, 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 he said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm just tuning up. He said, keep playing that. Keep playing that riff. So we worked on it. And then when he changed and said, doom, I changed and went to his key to play the same rhythm. He said, no, stay on your G. Stay on your G. Whatever I do, don't worry about me. Don't think about me. And then even when he got the doo 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 doo, I still was on G. Doom, 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 doom. And I'd say, we were doing some other stuff where he was saying, hit me twice, doom, doom, you know. Four, doom, 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 doom. I'm still on the same run. All through the whole damn entire structure, I haven't changed anything but the flavor of my foot. On the end, I used the F chord and said, wah, 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 wah. I had to do it then because that was over. And I was so happy to hit that. Wah, 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 wah. I was so damn glad. To me, it seemed repetitious, redundant, and ridiculous. Shows you what you know, all right? And at the time when it came out and I'm hitting it in the car, I still didn't like what I was doing. It was like, why did he let me do all that shit all through the song? You know, but then later on it started hitting on me. It started wearing on me, right? We did not know Shaft was gonna be Shaft. I mean, it got big, it was like, whoa.
I actually saw Isaac Hayes. That was actually my first concert. Isaac Hayes and Dionne Warwick. And when he played Shaft, and that wah pedal part came in, strobe light came on, and I thought, oh my God, this is just beyond cool. When you're in fifth grade, you know, and you see something like that, it's super impressionable.
A lot of people don't know this. What we recorded for the movie was for the movie. So what you hear on the LP is not the same thing that's on the movie. At that time, I was using a boomerang before the movie was released, if I'm not mistaken. We went back to Stax and recorded the same thing all over again. But we used the local musicians and recorded with the crybaby. So it sounds different when you hear that first piece. They got a boomerang at Stax that they said I play Shaft on. The crybaby, I don't know where it is. I'm not gonna lie to you. I have no idea. But if anybody find it, hey, they got a piece of work.